Well, I'm thankful everybody's here this morning. You can take your Bibles and let's turn to the book of Luke, Luke's Gospel, and let's look at the 24th chapter of Luke, chapter 24. Also, ladies, if you're interested in a Bible study, there is one that goes on here tonight, this afternoon at 4 o'clock. It's for ladies, Bible study, 4 o'clock this afternoon right here at the church. I want to make that available as well. Luke chapter 24. I guess we could ask the question this morning, did Christ really rise from the grave? Did he really come out of the grave? And true, but there are some, and sadly, probably majority of folks that would say, no, that never happened. Of course, that's the wrong answer. But they would say, no, that never happened. They give reasons like this. Well, what was commonly reported then was that the disciples came and stole his body away. They stole his body. So no, he did not rise from the grave. The disciples just stole his body. Others would say, no, he did not rise from the grave. There's this thing called the swoon theory, which says that Jesus didn't really die, that he was on the cross, beaten, yes, bloodied, yes, but he did not really die. And when he got in that the cool air of the tomb, revived him, and he came out alive. So he never really died. Did Christ really die from the dead? Some folks say no. The disciples, they were just hallucinating. They did not see Jesus. They saw what they thought was Jesus. They saw the spirit of Jesus, maybe. And so people answer that question, did Christ really rise from the dead? They say, no, he did not. But the authoritative statement on the matter comes from Matthew 28, 5 and 6. An angel said, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. So yes, he did rise from the grave. The word of God says that he rose from the grave. Well, what about that then, that the disciples stole his body, as commonly was reported at that time? Is that, what about that? How can you refute that? Well, we would say this. Number one, if the Roman guards who were guarding that tomb had let that happen, their lives would be in jeopardy. Probably they would be killed. You weren't doing your job, dereliction of duty. Corporal punishment, it's going to happen. Also, they say that the guards, the Roman guards that were watching, the reason the disciples were able to steal the body was because all the guards were asleep. Now let me ask you something. If you're asleep, how do you know what happened? If they're out there passed out, if anybody in here, who's a heavy sleeper in here? Yeah, you don't know. My Silas, he's a heavy sleeper. That boy he doesn't know what happens at nighttime. He has no idea. So, again, that doesn't even make sense to say that these battle-hardened Roman soldiers all fell asleep while the disciples, these scared disciples, came and moved a big, huge stone, and then they stole the body, and we were all asleep. But we know he stole the body. Wait a minute, time out. If you were asleep, how do you even know? And also, another reason we would say the disciples did not steal his body, because the grave clothes were left in perfect order in the tomb. The body was gone, but those grave clothes were all right there. Somebody said this, there is no order in haste. Burglars do not leave things in perfect order. They come in, they get what they want, and they get out of there. They don't leave it in perfect order. There is no order in haste. The disciples stole his body is false also, because in law, much is made of this word motive. What was their motive in committing the crime? What was their motive? What could have been the motive of the disciples? Stop and think about that. What was their motive? They were going to go steal this body, create a big fraud, and then give their lives for this? Now these were the same disciples that all fled when Jesus was arrested. They all ran away. And we find them in hiding later on. These are not men. Their motive was not to go steal a body and then tell everybody a big lie and put fraud out, to the place where every single one of them, except one, died a martyr's death. I mean, the Apostle Peter, tradition says, was crucified upside down. Now, what would be his motive? You're going to be crucified upside down, knowing that you stole the body and you're lying? People would say today, well, the Muslims die for their faith. That's true. And some Christians die for their faith. But this is different. I'll tell you why this is different. Muslims today are dying for a belief in something. They don't know whether it's true or false. They believe. These guys knew if it was true or false. It wasn't like they had heard. They knew. Did we steal his body or did we not steal his body? So no, they did not steal his body. What about, he didn't really die. What about that swoon theory where he merely was beaten and bruised, but he did not die. And when they laid him in the tomb, everybody thought he was dead, but then he raised from the dead when he got that cool air in the tomb and it revived him. How do you refute that? Well, I would say this. Well, after 3 days, he appeared not as a sick, beaten, you know, half-dead man. He appears rather as a victorious, here I am. We also would say that the soldiers who put him to death, when they came to him, they said, he's dead. There was no question. Pilate said, Joseph of Arimathea came and said, I want the body. Pilate says, is he dead already? Somebody go check. And they come back and they say, yeah, he's dead already. And Pilate said, okay, give him the body. And just to make sure, when they came to him, see, they had the three up there, you know, the three, the thieves on the cross and Jesus. And the custom was, if they want, the way you died by crucifixion, the way you died was basically suffocation. You got to the place where you could no longer lift yourself up to get a breath. And then they would slump back down. Then they would push up again. And they would use their legs to push up. But eventually they got so tired, and it was a gruesome and torturous way to kill a criminal. That's how they died. Basically, they died of suffocation. They came to these three on this day, and they wanted them all dead. So one thing that they would do, the Roman soldiers, as ruthless as they were, to speed up the process, they would take a big rod and break the legs of the people hanging on the cross. Therefore, they could no longer push up. They would just die sooner. They would suffocate quicker. But when they came to Jesus, they didn't break his legs because they saw he was already dead. One of the soldiers took a spear, and our medical folks in here would be able to tell us that if blood and water come out of the major organs, I mean, that's medically proven. You're dead. I mean, you are. That's a sign of you're not. You're dead. And so he didn't really die. He absolutely died. He was dead, and then, of course, his own testimony said, "I was dead. I was dead, and I am alive." What about they said, they didn't see him. They saw his ghost. They just simply saw a ghost of Jesus. They didn't really see his literal body. I mean, come on. Maybe they hallucinated and saw a spirit. But then we would say this, please explain the empty tomb. If it was just a spirit, why the empty tomb? That's a good argument for folks today. See, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is historically accurate. We're not believing a lot of fables today. This is factual stuff. We're not basing our faith upon just nonsense. This is real. He really died. He was really buried. But the empty tomb, there's this thing called cause and effect. It's an argument, a way that you would debate. It's called cause and effect. Everything that is an effect has a cause. The empty tomb is an effect. The question is, what's the cause? What caused the empty tomb? And then you could take that and say, well, either somebody stole him. Well, we know that didn't happen. Well, maybe he didn't really die. Well, we know that he really did die. What caused the empty tomb? I'll tell you what caused it. The resurrection of Jesus Christ. He came out of that grave. Another cause would be this. We're meeting on Sundays now. That's another effect would be the Jewish people that believed in Jesus no longer met on the Sabbath day. They now begin to meet on the first day of the week. That's an effect. What caused that? What caused the zealous, you talk about a zealous group of people, the Jewish nation. Good night. What would cause them to abandon thousands of years of tradition and that they've been zealous for? What would cause them and produce this new effect where they meet together on the first day of the week? Here's another effect. You're looking at it. The church. What caused this? Here we all are from all different walks of life, all different states, different countries, middle age, old age, young. We got them all in here today. Red, yellow, black, and white. They are precious in His sight. This is an effect. What's the cause? I submit to you that the only cause that would satisfy every one of those effects, the empty tomb, the church, the only thing that would satisfy all of those would be the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's the cause. It's undeniable. See, God doesn't set up here to try to get you to want you to prove it. He doesn't try to have to prove Himself. God tells you this is what happened. The burden's on us. Burden's on us. God's not like, oh man, I hope they don't try to have at it. Prove He did not rise from the grave. You know, a lot of people they set out in life to do that to prove Jesus did not rise from the grave. And what they come away with is becoming believers. They come away with, and they are then preachers of the truth. They are gospel preachers. And they go out and they say, I tried to disprove the resurrection, but I only learned that it's the truth. This man died, he was buried, and he rose again. And so, we come this morning to our Luke chapter 24. And I think the message, the proposition, the thrust of the message this morning is this. The risen Savior knows what you need. The risen Savior knows what you need. Look at Luke chapter 24, and we'll pick it up in verse 36. Jesus has already rose from the grave. Jesus has appeared to the disciples on the road to Emmaus, and they're walking, and He says to them, why? And He's hid Himself. They don't know it's Him. And He says, hey guys, why are you so upset? Why are you so mad? Why are you so sad? And they said, are you not just a stranger in Israel? Don't you know what's been going on around here? And they're walking to Emmaus, and they said, this Jesus, who was a prophet, mighty in works and deeds, they crucified Him, and we supposed that He was supposed to be the Messiah, and this is the third day since He's died, and now these ladies are coming and tell us that He's rose from the grave, and we don't know all the... And they're, you know, sad and upset, and Jesus says, you fools, slow of heart to believe. And so He's done all that, and then He appears to them in verse... look at verse 29. But they constrained Him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And He went in to tarry with them. And it came to pass, as He sat at meat with them, He took bread, and blessed it, and brake, and gave to them. And their eyes were opened, and they knew Him. And He vanished out of their sight. And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while He talked with us by the way, and while He opened to us the Scriptures? They rose up the same hour and returned to Jerusalem, found the 11 gathered together and them that were with them, saying, the Lord is risen indeed and hath appeared to Simon. So Jesus had appeared to them. And this is neat. The question asked sometimes, will we know each other in heaven? Could this be a clue here? They knew Him by the way He broke bread and gave thanks. It was the same on earth before the crucifixion and in the resurrection. Maybe that's an indication of, yeah, we'll know each other in heaven one day. Because the things that we do, the silly expressions that we make with one another, the look on our face sometimes, the way we walk, the way we shake our head, I mean, I don't know. Maybe this is an indication of, yeah, we will know each other in heaven one day in new bodies. This is going to be, you ought to come back tonight for the body, the look at the different body. It's going to be a wonderful thing. The body that we're going to get is going to be a spiritual body as opposed to a flesh body. Now that spiritual body is going to be flesh and bone, but it's going to be spirit. One author said that this body is a flesh body that contains the spirit, but the spirit body is going to be one that can change the flesh. Because sometimes Jesus was unrecognizable, but sometimes Jesus was recognizable. He had that. Sometimes he could pass through a wall, and sometimes he could eat fish. It was a spirit body that will be able to change fish. I don't know. That's why you ought to come back tonight. But, so let's begin reading in verse number 36. And as they thus spake, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and saith unto them, Peace be unto you. But they were terrified and affrighted and supposed that they had seen a spirit. And he said unto them, Why are you troubled? And why do thoughts arise in your hearts? Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit hath not flesh and bones, as ye see me have. And when he had thus spoken, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they yet believed not for joy and wondered, he said unto them, Have ye here any meat? And they gave him a piece of a broiled fish and of an honeycomb. And he took it and did eat before them. And he said unto them, These are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. Then opened he their understanding, that they might understand the scriptures, and said unto them, Thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer, and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem, and ye are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. And he led them out as far as to Bethany, and he lifted up his hands and blessed them. And it came to pass, while he blessed them, he was parted from them and carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and were continually in the temple, praising and blessing God. Amen. Speak to you this morning. Proposition, the Savior, risen Savior, knows what we need. He knows what you need. He knows what I need. He knew what these guys needed. Now, I, as I read this and was studying over this, I thought it was so sweet and so tender that here's Jesus with his disciples, and they are affrighted, the Bible says, and terrified. And you know what Jesus says to them? Guys, you guys got any food? That's what he said. The equivalent of today's, hey, you guys want to have a cup of tea together or something? Got a cup of coffee? Want to go get a cup of coffee? That's what he said. They're frightened, and he's there, and they're just like, what in the world? And he sweetly and tenderly with compassion. I want us to see the personality of Jesus, our Savior, who says, you guys got anything to eat? Come over here. Let me have, bring, yeah, thank you. Let's sit down. And he's eating in front of them. He makes it to where it's a relationship. It's sweet. He is assuring them, and he's comforting them simply by eating with them. What a beautiful thought. The nearness of the Savior. The compassion and the tenderness of the Savior. And he's eating with them. He knew what they needed. What did they need? Well, first of all, they needed assurance. They needed to know he was alive. And so verse 37 through 43, he tells them, Behold, verse 39, my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit hath not flesh and bones, as ye see me have. He rose in a real body. He wasn't a ghost. It wasn't an hallucination. It was really him. And he said, look at my hands, look at my feet, handle me, I'm real. If he walked through this door today, after we all got up off our faces from being in deity, we would look at him and say, he has a real body. It's not a spirit body. There's flesh to him. They needed to know that he was alive. And let me tell you something this morning. He is alive. He lives in heaven, and he lives in our hearts, and he's alive, and he's seated at the right hand of God. He's not dead. He's not in some grave. He's not a figment of our imagination. He is alive, my dear friend. And he can know all about you. He can do something about your situation. He's alive today. He's alive. They needed assurance that he was alive. Number two, the second thing they needed was understanding from the scriptures. They didn't understand everything. How many could side with them? I don't understand everything. When I got deployed to Africa, I had no idea. I had 7 months left in the Air Force. And I get tasked on like Thanksgiving Day, Senior Airman McKittrick, you're the only person in the Air Force that we can send to this assignment. Now, I'd been around a long time. I'm the only person in the Air Force. The only one. Okay. So I show up in Djibouti, Africa, and you know what they're like, checking the packs with, who are you? I said, I'm the only guy in the Air Force that could be here. We don't have you. I was like, we don't always understand everything. Don't understand everything. And they didn't understand everything, but I tell you, he directed their attention to some good understanding. Right to the Word of God. And a great principle of biblical interpretation is here. Look at verse number 44. If you want to interpret your Bible correctly, this is big. The Bible is a Christ-centric book. It all points to Jesus. It doesn't point to Mary. It all points to Jesus Christ. Listen to what he said. He said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses. That's Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, the Torah. Everything written in the law of Moses and in the prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, and in the Psalms. All of that. What's the meaning, Jesus? It's concerning me. It all is about Jesus. So when you go to read your Bible, they say this, look for Jesus on every page, because he's there. And when you're going through times of not understanding, I think this is good, look for Jesus. Just get a good look at Christ. Be refocused on the scriptures and what they teach about Jesus Christ, and we will find some comfort and some understanding that we might not have before. I tell you another thing they needed to know what was the next step. All right, what do we do now? He's alive. Man, he's opened up our understanding. What are we supposed to do now? What's the next step? Just sit back and relax and just warm a church pew? Is that what God wants us to do? I don't think so. Look at verse number 47. And that repentance and remission of sins should be preached. Should be preached. Should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things. What's the next step, Master? The next step is for you to go and preach the gospel. You're going to have to go to all nations and preach. What am I supposed to preach? Repentance and remission of sins. Repentance meant you change, it means to change one's mind. So we meet somebody and this person says, I don't believe in God. I don't think there's any such thing. And in fact, when I die, I think it's all over with. God wants them to repent. He wants them to change their mind. They're going in this direction of there's no such thing as God, and when I die, it's all over with. God wants them to understand and change their mind and say, no, there is a God, and there is a hell, and there is a heaven, and Jesus Christ makes the difference, and I'm going to trust in him. That's repentance. See, they've turned from their old theology. Thinking. Maybe they think this, I'm Japanese and I am raised to believe in Shintoism with Izanagi and Izanami, and they were the creator gods and they created Japan, and There are many gods, and so I'm going to believe in that. God, the real God, comes and says, no, that's not true. I need you to repent. I need you to change your mind. I'm commanding you, Acts chapter 17, all men everywhere to repent. Change it. Drop all of it and take him. Maybe today you're here and you think, well, I don't know that anybody can really know where they'll go when they die. I try to live a good life, and I hopefully at the end of it all, I'll go to heaven. God comes to you and says, you need to repent. That's faulty thinking. You can know where you're going to spend eternity. 1 John 5:13, these things have I written unto you that believe, that ye may know that you have eternal life. I know I have eternal life today. Woo! That feels good. I'll never go to hell, and I'll never spend eternity in the lake of fire. And I know that because God told me so. He said, if you believe in me, you have eternal life. It's not Jesus plus Buddhism, Jesus plus good works. It's Jesus only. And that's what's supposed to be preached. It's not time to sit around and just warm a church pew or just go about our daily business. God doesn't want us to be lukewarm. God doesn't want us to be cold. The God-man himself says, go and now preach repentance and remission of sins. Remission of sins means you can be forgiven of your sins. It means that they'll go away from you. Woo! I mean, God will forgive you of your sins. All of your sins go over on Jesus the moment you trust him. And all of his righteousness comes over on you. And you stand complete, forgiven, justified, imputed righteousness to your spiritual account. And the only way you get that is through repentance and believing, just simple faith. Like a child, childlike faith. God says, if I believe, he'll save me. Oh God, I believe. I'm not trusting in anything else. I'm only trusting in Christ. That's what we're supposed to be doing. That was the next step for them. That repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. The final thing they needed was power from on high. And you guys, if we want to live a victorious Christian life, we're not going to find it in ourselves. It's only going to be found when we yield ourselves to the Holy Spirit of God. I look at verse number 49. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. These guys had a job to do. They were supposed to go preach repentance and remission of sins to all nations. But Jesus says, you can't do it in your own power. You're going to have to wait until I send the Holy Spirit. I like that phrase, until you're endued with power from on high. Boy, I need that in my life. I need that in my marriage. I need that in raising my children. I need the endowment of the power of God on my life to be a preacher. Whatever it is, we need God. I love your song, Brother Tim. Oh, Lord, I need thee. And we need God. And they needed God. But Jesus knows what we need. And he says, the risen Savior says, I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. I send the promise of my Father. You just wait until you be endued with power from on high. And so today, I ask this. If you died today, if it all ended, do you know where you would spend eternity? It's one of two places. It's either heaven or hell. It's the good news. The gospel means good news. The good news starts with bad news. That man is a sinner. We're born that way. We come out with a sin nature, and we sin against God. The Bible says it like this in Romans chapter 3, verse 10. There is none righteous. No, not one. Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Not a person in here today could say, I have perfectly served God from the day I was born. No one, we know that. We've sinned against God. We've done things we shouldn't have done. We've had attitudes that we shouldn't have had. We've not done things that we were supposed to do. We're sinners. We've sinned against God. And the Bible says that those who will go through their life and not do anything about the sin that has separated them from God, they just go through this life and I'm just going to try to make rank and I'm keeping on going, keep my head down, I'm going to be a good dad, I'm going to do this. I know I'm a sinner, but I just ain't got time to worry about that right now. I got a career on the line, I got family on the line, I got this going on. Well, I don't got time to worry about that right now. If that person goes through life, and sadly many do, they never even stop to consider, you're separated from God. See, He's a holy, righteous God. And we are sinners. We have sinned against Him. If that person goes through life and doesn't do anything about sin, the moment they die, their soul goes to hell, where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth, and where there is eternal fire, and eventually they'll be resurrected, and their body will be resurrected, and they'll be brought out of hell, and their soul and body and spirit will stand before God, not to find out whether you're going to heaven, because you're not going to heaven. You'll be judged how bad it's going to be for you in the lake of fire. And it's going to be bad. It's at the great white throne judgment. You do not want to be a part of the great white throne judgment. And I won't be. And you won't be either if you're a believer in Christ. I'm getting to that. This is still bad news. A man who is a sinner, and none of us in here would try to say anything different. We would all have to, agree. We're sinners. If you don't do anything about your sin problem, and God might be merciful unto you, He might let you live to be 117 years old because God's long-suffering. But if you don't do anything about your sin problem, when you die, you will spend eternity, go to hell, and eventually spend eternity in the lake of fire. That's the bad news. But I've got good news. Remember, we said it's good news. The gospel is good news. That's the meaning of the word, good news. Here's the good news, that the very God that we've sinned against still loves us. The God who we have cursed His name and said we don't have anything to do with you, He still loves you. There's nothing you can do that will stop Him from loving you. Can't do it. Because He made a choice to love you. Unconditional. Whether you love Him back or not, He loves you. And He wanted to show you. So He left heaven Himself and came to earth. And was born in a manger, in a sinless body. He was born of a virgin. We're all sinners. He was not a sinner. He had no sin. He was holy, harmless, undefiled, separated from sinners. Born of a virgin, lived a sinless life, raised people from the dead, caused the blind to see, forgave sins. And when they said, who can forgive sins but God only? He says, now you're catching on. I'm God. Walks on water. Eventually, for crimes He never even did, but for your sins and for my sins, He willingly got on the cross. And God the Father judged God the Son. And at the end of it, Jesus says, it is finished. Bowed His head, and He died. And they buried Him for 3 days, but they couldn't, that tomb couldn't hold Him. And after 3 days, Jesus rose from the grave. And we're celebrating it today. That's been over 2,000 years ago. And here we are still talking about it. Amen. This is the good news, that He died for you. He died in your place, in my place. All of your sins were put on Him. Every sin of all time was put on the Lamb of God. And He died and was buried and rose again the third day. And then we see what He said. Go preach. Go tell them all. Repentance, remission of sins. You can be saved today. Here's the good news. You don't have to do a thing to be saved. All you got to do, and this is hard, humble your heart. Admit that you're not righteous. Admit that He is righteous. admit that I need him, and like a child, maybe get on your knees, maybe in your heart, whatever. Oh, God, I know I'm a sinner, but I believe Jesus died in my place, that he was buried and he rose again. And, oh, God, I understand that's the gift of salvation that you're offering to me. And by faith, like a little child, I receive that. At that very moment, you become a child of his. You'll never hit hell. You'll never be in the lake of fire. I like the thief on the cross. Remember me when thou comest into paradise. No time to get down and get baptized. No time to get down and live a good life. To atone for all of his sins. He didn't have any time for that. In his last breath, he said, oh God, remember me. And Jesus said, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. What a wonderful truth. But listen, dear friend, don't you wait to your deathbed to make that decision. Because we're not promised of another day. God is merciful. God is long-suffering. He will save in the death breath, in your last breath. He will save you because he's that good. But if I were you, I would not put that off. Don't put that off. If you don't know him as your Savior, why don't you trust him today? Eternity with in heaven with the Lord, all because of Easter 2017, I trusted Christ to be my Savior. Let's close in prayer. Our Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you that you know just what we need. Father, that you came out of the grave. You were resurrected. You've never died again. It's not even possible for you to ever go through that again. We thank you, Lord, for the assurance that we have that you are alive, the understanding that you provide through the Scriptures. Lord, for the job that we now have, we know what's next. We're supposed to be preaching and telling others about Jesus Christ. Father, we need your power. We need the Spirit of God upon our lives in every aspect, yielding ourselves to his leadership and to his control. I pray that you would bless now the invitation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.